Hello and welcome to a new Blender Developer sneak peek. It's episode 9 already. My name is Thomas Beck and I'd like to show you today some cool new features that were added since last week. So let's start. The first thing I'd like to show you is concerning tabs. And you know already that we got tabs here in the edit mode, I think, and in the object mode. But what you didn't know until now was that when you are holding control and moving your mouse wheel, then you could switch between the tabs. So that's a quick and easy way to switch the tabs. And the next thing that is tabs concerning is in the image editor. When you get an image in the image editor, then you are able to press N, and not please notice that N is opening the right panel and T is opening the left panel, just as in the 3D view. We changed that as well because that is much more convenient this way. And you can see that we got tabs in there too with the scopes. That's a tool, that therefore it's in the tool panel. And a grease pencil tab that we got all around Blender now. And that was it for tabs, I think. The next thing I'd like to show you is the new numInput key and numInput change that Bastian was introducing just today, just a few minutes ago. And that is to have a special key to enter an extended numeric input mode in Blender. So let's switch to the 3D view and start the screencast keys so you can see what I'm doing. And I don't know if you have watched my previous videos, but in one of those videos you can see that we now have a new input mode that is activated just by hitting G, S, or R. And then you could enter some formulas directly and navigate via the cursor buttons to the right number and change that and so on. But as many of you were complaining about that, we rethought that. And in fact, it's like this. Many of you were used to enter G and then 2 and minus, for example, to mirror it. And with the extended mode, this wasn't possible because then you would have 2 and minus and he would await a new number for that to work. So now Bastian changed it like this. When you are using G and hitting nothing but numbers and minus or something like that, then it's just behaving as before. Just 3, minus, minus again, minus, minus again. So that is behaving like before. But when you are doing it like this, G, then hitting multiply on the numpad, you won't see that now in the screencast keys, I think. And then, for example, let me just do it again. G multiply on the numpad and then enter sinus 90. Then you would see it works just as it is intended to. And so you could very easily switch between the normal mode, the G or R, 4 minus, or S 7 minus, like that. But when you are needing the extended mode, then just hit multiply on the numpad or the equal sign on the normal keyboard for all the English guys. Because in French, I think in French it is working, but in German it isn't. So we need to tap the multiply key. So yeah, that's it. Now let's straight on go to the last thing The last thing I'd like to show you is in the MCE, in the movie clip editor. And let me just load some simple footage for, yeah, let's do it with this. What I'd like to show you is when you are adding some markers or tracking points, then you got here the camera presets. And as you see now, Sebastian and I think one other guy that I don't remember, sorry for that, we're adding more presets, much more presets than we had before. Now there are some things like the GoPro Hero 3, black, silver and white. We got even got the iPhone 5, 4S and 4. So you should be really, really prepared to track much more footage without finding out the camera data first. Be warned though, because the GoPro Hero 3 or much what else? I think the iPhone is supported, but no, the GoPro Hero 3 black, silver and white models have a really large distortion, and we got a really decent tracker now that would be possible to track it still. But be warned, it could be that your tracking fails with the GoPro. I own one myself, so I could say it is working all the time, every time I tried, but it's not, so to say, officially supported, and it could cause glitches. But those are the camera presets, and it's really handy to have them here, I think. The next thing is the MCE masking. So let's switch to the mask and insert a new one like this. When we are now drawing our mask like this, then we can see, okay, we got a mask, but what happens if we duplicate it? This behavior that you're seeing here is wanted most of the time. So that is really cool. And in fact, that is the change already, because Sergey activated the new option per default. And let me just switch off the default option. That is, how is it called? Damn it. No, not self-intersection check. Holds, there it is. And when you are looking at this mask now, then you can see it's behaving like our curves in Blender. So everywhere where it intersects, the mask is emptied out. But that is most of the time really not wanted. You'd like to have a mask that is overlaid, and you have many different portions of your footage that you are masking out, and when those masks are overlapping, then you don't want to have this holds. So we got a new option now to turn this off, and now we got nice, fluent and complete masking, and that is really handy. So thanks Sergey for that. And in fact, this was already the new Blender Developer sneak peek. It's not that much, but I think there were some really handy features in there. Just be aware that we are releasing Blender in, I think, 1 week or maybe two. The first release candidate is already out there, so you should go and grab it. I will supply the link in the description. So that was it. All you have to do now is share the video, make the features well known around the community to make the first contact with Blender 2.7 as easy as possible. Subscribe on YouTube, on Vimeo or on Twitter. We are very happy to see you there and to chat with you. And we'll see us next time. Keep on blending. See ya.